suppose God searched through heaven and couldn't find one willing to be the supreme sacrifice that was needed to buy eternal life for you and me. Had it not been for a place called Mount Calvary, had it not been for the old rugged cross, had it not been for a man called Jesus, then forever my soul would be lost. But I'm so glad he was willing to drink his bitter cup. Although he prayed, "Father, let it pass from me." And I'm so glad he didn't call heaven's angels. From my hand pull these nails that torment me. Had it not been for a place called Mount Calvary, had it not been for the old rugged cross, had it not been for a man called Jesus, then forever my soul would be lost. Then forever my soul would be lost.
That love touch you today. Let's pray. Father, something you want us to truly understand today is that you love us. We've heard that so many times, but how many times did it really sink in? I'm asking you this morning that you'll break every barrier, remove every obstacle, so that every person here will be touched in a fresh way by your love. Father, you're all that we need. You're more than able to meet every need that we may have in our life, and we praise you today. And that's how we want to approach the throne of grace today, with praises to you, our Heavenly Father, who cares enough that he's aware of everything that goes on in our life. You look beyond our sin and you see our heart and you touch our need. We praise you that you don't leave us empty and alone, but you reach in and you touch us with your grace. So we bring ourselves to you this morning, some with joy and some with sorrow. Whatever it is, we come and we gather around your throne. Lord, look to our hearts and help us to know that we have a God who's going to take care of us. Help us to trust in what you want to do in our lives today. Maybe some of us came in here weak, and you're going to make us strong. Maybe it's someone here who feels broken, and they need you to heal. Maybe it's someone who's burdened under the load of life, and you're going to lift them. Whatever it is, Lord, we know you're here. And so I ask that you'll help us to look up to you and say, I trust you. Father, I trust you for the way you're going to use your word to move in our hearts today. And Father, I pray that you would still our minds and quiet our hearts as we approach this communion table today. Help each one here to meet with you now and allow you to examine our hearts and in this time of communion as a church family. We thank you for the elements, Lord, the bread and the cup. We come this morning together in grateful remembrance of what you did for each one of us on the cross. And we look forward to your coming back for us. So it's in the mighty, loving name of Jesus we pray. And all God's people said, amen. Can I have the ushers come and pass the elements, please? All right, well... Now, I'm told this is a true story, but I can't confirm it. So later on, you can tell me what you think. And the story goes that Billy Graham was returning to Charlotte after a speaking engagement. And when his plane arrived, there was a limousine there waiting to transport him to his home. And he was about to get in the limo, and he stopped. And he says to the driver, you know, I'm 87 years old and I've never driven a limo. Would you mind if I drove it for just a bit? The driver tells him, you know what? No problem. Have at it. I'll be in the back. And so Billy Graham gets into the driver's seat and they head off down the highway. And a short distance away, there's this rookie state trooper operating his first speed trap. And here comes that long black limo. It's doing 70 in a 55 zone. So the trooper pulls out and catches up to the limo, and he gets out of his patrol car, and he walks up to the driver's door. And when the window rolled down, he was pretty surprised to see who it was driving. He immediately excused himself, and he goes back to his car, and he calls a supervisor. And he tells the supervisor, I know we're supposed to enforce the law, but I also know that important people are given certain courtesies. I need to know what I'm supposed to do here because I've stopped a very important person. And the supervisor asks him, is it the governor? And the young trooper says, no, he's more important than that. And the supervisor says, oh, so it's the president? And he says, no, it's even more important than that. And the supervisor finally asks, well, then who is it? And the young trooper goes, I think it's Jesus because he's got Billy Graham for a chauffeur. You think that's a true story? Some things are hard to believe, aren't they? Have you ever had something happen to you where you think, no one's going to believe this really happened to me? Well, today I need to tell you something that I hope isn't too hard to believe, something very important. Okay, you ready for this? God loves you. And you're probably thinking, yeah, I know that. But I'm not so sure you really know that. And so many of us have heard that so much in all our years at church, but for too many, it never made it from their head down to their heart. And I don't want to take it for granted that people really know and believe that God loves them. And often when speaking with someone who's lost a loved one or has suffered in some way, I hear something that maybe some of you have heard. God must be really mad at me, or or God must not really like me very much, right? Have you ever heard something like that? We shouldn't just assume that people believe that God loves them. But this morning, I want you to hear from the God of promise, this promise. I have loved you with an everlasting love. We need to hear that today. Not just hear somebody say it and then go on our day, but hear it in a way that it'll somehow make it from your head down to your heart, that God loves you. We've been talking about God's promises and examining that a little closer and trying to get to know and understand God better. And if you've been here, maybe you remember we started with talking about the promise of God's presence. And he says, I'll always be with you. I'll never leave you or forsake you. And then last time we talked about the promise of God's awareness. God knows where you're at and he's watching over your life. And then today I want to talk about the promise of his love. I have loved you with an everlasting love. It's important that we understand that love today. There's a woman that we find in Scripture, and we have no name for her. Her story is found in chapter 4 of the Gospel of John. So go ahead and grab your Bibles and open up with me to John chapter 4. John chapter 4. It's kind of interesting that no name is mentioned for this person in the Scriptures. I heard someone say that one way to look at it is that it happened that way so that you can insert your name where hers isn't. What do you think? But this person had the privilege of meeting the Lord in a special way. So I wonder how she would tell us about the love of God. I bet she would say some dynamic, powerful lessons about the love of God. So let's look at that today. Just four lessons about the love of God, and I hope it'll get from your head to your heart, okay? The first lesson I think this lady would tell us is that God's love is accepting. El amor de Dios es la aceptación. God's love is an accepting love. In other words, it's unconditional. It's a love for you. John chapter 4, beginning in verse 1. Are you ready? Now Jesus learned that the Pharisees had heard that he was gaining and baptizing more disciples than John, although in fact it was not Jesus who baptized, but the disciples. The Lord left Judea and went back once more to Galilee. Now he had to go through Samaria, so he came to a town in Samaria called Sychar, near the plot of the ground of Jacob had given to his son Joseph. Jacob's well was there, and Jesus, tired as he was from the journey, sat down by the well. It was about noon when a Samaritan woman came to draw water. Jesus said to her, "Will you give me a drink?" His disciples had gone into town to buy food. The Samaritan woman said to him, "You are a Jew, and I am a Samaritan woman. How can you ask me for a drink?" For Jews did not associate with Samaritans. May God add his blessing to the reading of his word. You know, I want you to notice where it says Jews do not associate with Samaritans. Those words speak volumes about the accepting and unconditional love of God. See, our passage starts out talking about the Pharisees. The Pharisees were a religious group in those days, in case you didn't know, and they were very strict about keeping the rules. And the Pharisees loved to count and compare and see who measured up and who didn't, religiously and morally speaking. And this group of Pharisees noticed that Jesus and his disciples were baptizing and making more converts than John the Baptist and his disciples, like it was a competition or something. Now, in our day, churches never count and compare, do we? But anyway, when Jesus heard about this, he left Judea and headed to Galilee. He wasn't looking to get into any kind of competition with his cousin John. So Jesus is traveling from Judea. Just real quick, raise your hand if you're the type that likes to look at the maps in the back of your Bible. Yeah, a few of us. Well, then you'll appreciate this. If you were to look at the map in your Bible, you'll see that Judea is in the southern part of Israel. Jesus is going back to Galilee, which is the northern part of Israel. And in between the two is the area of Samaria. Now, everybody knows that the shortest distance between two points is a straight line, right? The quickest way would be to go straight through Samaria. But that wasn't the only way to get to Galilee. Most Jews, especially religious Jews, would take a longer indirect route. It was kind of a roundabout, if you can imagine, so that they would avoid the area as much as possible. He could have gone around, but it would have taken longer, so he went straight through Samaria. And it took about 3 days' journey. On his way through Samaria, he stopped at the well of Jacob. It was a well that was very deep and very old. And this well was a place with a long history of significance. Jacob was a grandson of Abraham, who was the father of the 12 tribes of Israel. Jacob had purchased this well with 100 pieces of silver and eventually gave it to his son Joseph. Okay? So Jesus sat down by the well as his disciples head off to town, and they grabbed some food, and it's almost high noon. The sixth hour was noon for them, and he's sitting there in the hot, dry sun, and along comes this woman. She walks up by herself, and she begins to draw water. So Jesus asks her for a drink. He's tired. It's hot. You want some water. But what you need to realize is that this simple request from Jesus, a male Jew, to this woman, a female Samaritan, it would have just blown her mind. You see, first of all, Jews did not speak to Samaritans. They were enemies. These races had been at war for 400 years. The Hatfields and McCoys had nothing on these people. That's why most Jews would walk clear around that area rather than pass through there. So for a Jew to even talk to a Samaritan was very unusual. And yet Jesus reaches across that barrier. And he reached out to that woman. Why? Because God's love is an accepting, unconditional kind of love. Amen? Also, if the racial barrier wasn't enough, add to the fact that Jesus was a man and she was a woman. And those who considered themselves righteous Jews never spoke to a woman in public, not even if it was their own wife or their daughter. It was the culture. You just didn't do it. And yet, here's this man talking to this woman. To do so would have been considered a forbidden act, taboo, scandalous. Orthodox Jews would wake up every morning and pray a prayer, something like, Lord, I thank you that, first of all, I'm not a Samaritan, and second, that I'm not a woman. And yet here was Jesus reaching across that barrier and reaching out to this woman. Why? Because the love of God is an accepting, unconditional love. Do you believe that? It says it right there in Jeremiah 31. I have loved you with an everlasting love, says the Lord. We talked a little bit about the names of the Lord behind the promises. And in Jeremiah, it's recorded there that the Lord Yahweh, the great I am, has said, I have loved you with an everlasting love. He's saying, look, the great I am is saying, I have loved you. Because my love depends on who I am and not who you are. That's an accepting kind of love. That's an unconditional love. That's a love that means he loves us regardless. He loves every single person that way. The man who cheated on his wife, God loves him that way. The woman who had an abortion, God loves her. The woman who's drowning in the sea of sin, God loves them. The businessman who spends more time at his work than with his family, God loves him. God's love is accepting and unconditional. And if there's anything that moves from your head to your heart today, I hope it's this. God knows everything there is to know about you, and he loves you anyway. He knows everything there is to know about you, the good, the bad, and the ugly, and he loves you anyway. I mean, we can be some really stubborn goofballs sometimes, can't we? Rascals, you can say. You know, when I was a teenager, our youth leader used to call us pinheads. But God loves us not because we're lovable, but because he is love. And his love is accepting and unconditional. Another lesson I think this woman would teach us is that God's love is transforming. Look at verses 10 through 15 with me. Jesus answered her, "If you knew the gift of God and who it is that asks you for a drink, you would have asked him and he would have given you living water." "Sir," the woman replied, "you have nothing to draw with and the well is deep. Where can you get this living water? Are you greater than our father Jacob, who gave us the well and drank from it himself, as did also his sons and his livestock?" Jesus answered, "Everyone who drinks this water will be thirsty again, but whoever drinks the water I give them will never thirst. Indeed, the water I give them will become in them a spring of water welling up to eternal life." The woman said to him, "Sir, give me this water so that I won't get thirsty and have to keep coming here to draw water." What's going on here? Jesus asked the woman for a drink, and now he's offering her water. That sounds kind of weird, right? All this talk about water. In verse 12, where the woman asked, "Are you greater than our father Jacob, who gave us the well and drank from it himself, as did also his sons and his livestock?" In other words, you can't be all that now, can you? It's like she's trying to find an excuse as to why Jesus couldn't possibly be the one to offer living water. But Jesus continues to offer. He continues to press in. You know, Jesus was talking to her about the well of God's love. It's the well of God's love that you could draw out of and find forgiveness. The well of God's love that you could draw out of and find grace that can transform your life. It's the well of God's love that reaches out to you and grabs you where you're at and changes anything about you that needs to be changed. It's the well of God's love that's as deep as it is wide, and it's deeper than any sin could ever reach and destroy. You see, God loves you, okay? God loves you, and he wants you to love him. He wants a relationship with you. And in order to have a relationship with you, he knows that he's got to remove some barriers that stand in the way of that relationship. So his love is a transforming love. It reaches in and changes anything in your life that needs to be changed. And this woman had some things that needed to be changed. Jesus offers her this water, and she sidesteps the whole issue. So she says in verse 15, "Why don't you just give me some of that water so I won't have to come to this dumb well anymore?" She's trying to sidestep the issue of transformation, this forgiveness, this cleansing that Jesus wants to bring to her life. And she says, "Just give me the water, okay?" But Jesus, full of grace, looks right back at her, and he gets right back to the point. You see, this woman didn't want cleansing of her soul. She just wanted the refreshment of the water. Like so many today, she wanted the salvation. She just didn't want the transformation. Listen, so many folks want the blessing in their life. So many folks want the love of God to touch them and bless them and work for them and do great things. They just don't want him to change anything in their life. We want the salvation of God, but we don't want the change that he wants to do in us. God's love is not only an accepting love, it's also a transforming love. Look at verses 16 to 18 now. He told her, go, call your husband and come back. I have no husband, she replied. Jesus said to her, you are right when you say you have no husband. The fact is, you have had five husbands, and the man you have now is not your husband. What you have just said is quite true. This woman tried to sidestep the issue. She says, just give me the water. Don't talk about this cleansing stuff. And Jesus says back to her, okay, then go get your husband and come back. Here's this guy that didn't care that I was a Samaritan. He talked to me even though I'm a woman. He is the closest thing to acceptance I've ever experienced. And now he's talking about that. What am I supposed to say to him? That I'm a five-time loser, a failure? That the guy I'm with now won't even give me his name? So she tries some clever doublespeak, if you would. She says, well, I don't have a husband. So there. Okay, she wasn't necessarily lying, was she? But Jesus knew what was going on. And with honesty and compassion, he says, well, yes, that's true. The fact of the matter is you've been married five times, and you're not even married to the man you're now with. Wow. What was Jesus trying to say here? What are you getting at? I thought he loved her unconditionally. I thought Jesus loved us so much that he just accepts us the way we are. Why is Jesus talking like that? Well, listen, God's love isn't only an accepting love, it's a transforming love. And you need to understand something today. God's love always accepts you the way you are, but God's love never leaves you the way you are. God wants to transform your life. He wants to take your sin and replace it with his righteousness. He wants to take your bitterness and replace it with his graciousness. He wants to take your anger or your pride or your lust and cleanse you by his love. You see, God's love always accepts you the way you are, but God's love never leaves you the way that you are. So many people want to experience God's love, but you don't want to let him change what he wants to change in your life. Today, let the love of God get from your head to your heart and let him begin to work his transforming work in your life. Another lesson when this woman would teach us is that God's love is also healing. God's love is healing. Now look at Jesus and this woman again, verses 25 to 30. The woman said, I know that Messiah, called Christ, is coming. When he comes, he will explain everything to us. Then Jesus declared, I, who speak to you, am he. Just then, disciples returned and were surprised to find him talking with a woman. But no one asked, what do you want? Or why are you talking with her? Then, leaving her water jar, the woman went back to the town and said to the people, come, see a man who told me everything I ever did. Could this be the Messiah? They came out of the town and made their way toward him. Now please notice where it says, leaving her water jar. The woman went back to the town and said to the people, come, see a man who told me everything I ever did. I want to make sure that you catch this. Verse 6 tells us that this woman had come to the well at noon. Why at noon? Nobody came to the well at noon. They came early in the morning or late at night to avoid the heat, right? Hey, we're in Fort Mojave. We can understand this. So why did she come to the well at noon and not early in the morning or late at night? You see, she wanted to avoid everybody else who was there in the morning and at night. She had had enough of their insults, their constant stares. She knew the life that she had. She knew what the whispers were about, and she couldn't stand to face them and feel the guilt and the shame. So she came to the well right in the middle of the day, when it's the hottest, when no one else would be around there. and she brings her jar with her, and she gets to the well, and she meets Jesus, the Messiah, the one who has come, the God of promise, who's saying, I love you, and I'll forgive you, and I'll transform you. And suddenly this woman takes off out of there, and she leaves her water jar behind. That jug that had caused a slump in her shoulders, that jar that had been a heavy burden on her back, she left it behind. And you need to realize today that God had put that in the word there so that you would know that you can leave your burden behind as well. Amen? That God's love is more than able to heal you. God's love is able to take whatever it is that you're up against and heal you in an incredible way. Have you been carrying a load around that you need to leave at his feet? Is there a burden that you need to let him lift off your back? God can heal you. He wants to do it because he loves you and his love is healing. Do you need to let God heal you today? Maybe from a past memory that keeps coming up and you can't seem to let it go and it's damaging your spirit or your relationships. Let God heal that. Maybe it's loneliness or depression or addiction. He's more than able to heal it. Well, then lesson number four, the love of God is empowering. I want you to catch one more dynamic lesson from this woman at the well. Verses 39 to 41, it says, many of the Samaritans from that town believed in him because of the woman's testimony. This five-time marriage reject, that's how they saw her. They looked at her that way. She became such a powerful witness to the Lord to the point that many, not a few, but many of the Samaritans from that town believed in him because of the woman's testimony. He told me everything I ever did. So when the Samaritans came to him, they urged him to stay with them, and he stayed 2 days. And because of his words, many more became believers. What I want you to see here is that God's love empowered this woman to touch the lives of others. She went from brokenhearted to blessing. She went from loneliness to graciousness. She went from hiding to helping. God's love changed her and empowered her to touch others and bless them. Now listen, God's love reaches out to people that nobody else could use and uses them like nobody else could. That means you too. God specializes in taking people that nobody else could love and loving them and allows his love to flow through them. It's the promise of his love, and it's the promise for you here today. And the God of promise is a God who says, I love you. So let me ask you, do you need that love to touch you today? Do you need a touch from the love of God that will give you a fresh blessing of his grace? Do you need him to change some things in your life? Jesus wants to heal you. And I know that the God of promise is the God who says, my love can heal you. Are you going to let him do it? Please stand with me as we close in prayer. Lord, I think that most of us know that you love us, but sometimes we don't let that get from our heads to our hearts. And Lord, there's some here who need you to wash over them with your love to where it'll transform them. And I pray that you'll help them to reach out to you and let you change some things. Bitterness, anger, hatred, whatever it may be that's strangling their spirit. Grant that they'll know today the love of God that'll change them forever. And I thank you for your love. When I'm weak and when I'm strong, you love me. You know everything there is about me, and you still love me. Thank you that your love is still changing my life today. And now I ask that you'll bless these here today, reach into the struggle of their heart, the brokenness, the fear, the loneliness, whatever it might be. just wash over them with your love today. For some, maybe it's memories that you need to take out of their lives to where you bring them healing. For some, it may be their marriage or a relationship that needs healing. I ask you to heal with hope, with grace, with renewal, and let these here know that you've lifted that burden away. We trust you and we love you. And so we pray these things in the powerful, loving name of Jesus. And all God's people said, amen. Amen. Thank you for listening. Encourage someone this week. One more song.